Welcome back, everyone. Great to see you all again, and thank you for spending your valuable time. What I'd like to present today is our third year CompSci InfiniBand introduction course. Pretty much what this covers is the week-long Mellanox training course, but I've compressed it down into a fairly short, say 80 to 90 minutes. So I may go through some of this a little faster than I normally would. And I'm seeing a lot of existing network engineers around the room. I'm happy to answer questions along the way, but if possible, could we leave them towards the end? That way I can just answer a batch of questions. But please feel free to interrupt me if I'm going too fast or you think you'd like me to cover something in a bit more detail. So let's begin. I started in systems and networks in the 80s. I installed the first Ethernet and fiber optic Ethernet in Australia. I've dealt with more protocols than I care to remember, going back for original DECnet with X25, SNA, satellite, TCP, and most recently in collaboration with ACRC, extended rooted InfiniBand covering around the world. This has ranged from 110 bits per second up to 100 gigabits per second. I created and owned a national internet service provider in Australia, and we built a microwave network covering most of the state of Victoria. I worked for ARNNET as chief engineer for a number of years, also working on national and international projects. I'm one of the architects of ICON, the Intra-Commonwealth Optical Network, 188,000 kilometres of dark fibre, which connects all functions of Australian government in Canberra. I worked for the Australian National University on advanced communications research, and more recently at the National Computational Infrastructure as network manager. So our learning objectives today are going to be looking at an introduction to InfiniBand. We'll look at the InfiniBand feature set, InfiniBand layers, InfiniBand elements, and topologies and use cases. Before I begin on InfiniBand itself, I need to give you our normal NCI introduction. Like NSCC, we're the National Supercomputing Centre in Australia, where the most highly integrated high-performance research computing environment within Australia. We are actually located on the ANU campus in Canberra. We're built to deliver on national priorities and research experience across a range of scientific disciplines. We're federally funded through what our program here, which is called NCRIS, National Collaborative Research Infrastructure Strategy. And we're partnered kind of effectively owned by the Australian National University, the Commonwealth Scientific Industrial Research Organisation, CSIRO, the Bureau of Meteorology, Geoscience Australia, which is our land management and satellite imaging facility, Intersect, the Queensland Cyber Infrastructure, and a consortium of universities, including the Australian National University of Monash, Adelaide, University of New South Wales, Sydney, RMIT, Queensland, and Deakin. So NCI is split into two components, our research engagement initiatives, which does things like project management and community engagement. We've also got a programming team over there who do data services and virtual laboratories, and a computational chemistry team. On the other side is services and technologies. We're the operational side of the organisation. We run the communications, the HPC and cloud systems, have business management, have our user services and support team, have the storage team, the networks team, and we operate the data centre. So I'd like to give you a brief view inside our facility. This is the our computer room is located on the first floor rather than the 17th. We've got currently a system with around 57,500 cores of Sandy Bridge. and an additional agility system, which is based on Broadwell. Our InfiniBand technology is what's called fully fat tree. Sorry, our topology is fully fat tree. I'll be discussing InfiniBand topologies as I move later on. What this involves is having four 622-port core InfiniBand switches and connected to a number of top of rack switches to give us the capability to directly connect around 60 to 70,000 discrete computing devices within the data center. The previous slide I showed you is one of our top of rack switches, and this is one of our six 622-port InfiniBand core switches. We've got a number of systems, including a Cray, and the photo on the left is our newest storage pod, which is around another 30 terabytes of spinning disk storage. Our HPC system is around 84,500 cores as a combination of Sandy Bridge, which is becoming quite old, and Broadwell. We also have 120 Tesla K80s and eight Pascal GPUs and two nodes. We've got Knights Landing, so Xeon Phi. We've got four IBM Power 8 nodes, around 300 terabytes of main memory across all of the nodes in the facility. We've got a hybrid FDR and HDR Mellanox InfiniBand fat tree. I'll be explaining what these terms mean as I go along. We have about 8 petabytes of high performance operational storage capacity, that's our scratch space, connected to around 60 petabytes of permanent global data storage. And we run a combination of FDR, which is full data rate, 56 gig, and EDR, which is extended data rate, 100 gig InfiniBand Ethernet with a full battery topology. We operate three clouds, Tengen, which is our 33.5 teraflop private cloud. It uses OpenStack and has the capability to run another 56 gig Ethernet or 56 gig InfiniBand mode. Nectar is a national e-research cloud. It once again uses OpenStack, but with a 56 gig Ethernet only interconnect. We also have a production cloud, which is based on VMware, which uses a 10 gig Ethernet switch backbone. So MCI pride ourselves on having the fastest file systems in the Southern Hemisphere. We have around 140 gigabytes per second of sustained I/O throughput through multiple Lustre file systems. That should be 67.1 petabytes over multiple file systems. These are all connected together using 56 gig FDR and InfiniBand. And we have three tape silos, one in this data center, one in our secondary data center on campus, and a third at a government agency on the other side of the city. Our networks at NCI range from 10 gig Ethernet through 56 gig Ethernet to our most recent 100 gig Ethernet. We also have a combination of 40, 56 and 100 gig InfiniBand. We have multiple uplink connections to our national research network, RNet. We do a lot of work internationally. One of my key areas is monitoring and the operation and the design of our externally facing science DMZs, which are basically a zone outside of the controlled network environment, which is configured for high speed data transfer. And your colleagues, Joachim and Alvin, are working with NCI to set up the next generation of DTNs capable of operating 100 gigs per second. So let's move on to what is InfiniBand. So InfiniBand is a switch fabric architecture. It's typically an interconnect technology which connects the CPUs of many systems together and the I/O capabilities of their disk storage system. It's really super high performance. It runs high bandwidth between 10 gigabytes per second and 200 gigabytes per second. It has a very low latency with a very fast application response, less than 1 microsecond end-to-end. It has extremely low utilization when compared to a TCP/IP-based network. By using a technique called remote direct memory access, two systems are able to communicate with each other, and this bypasses a large amount of code in a traditional TCP network would have to execute to move a packet between two systems. InfiniBand was originally designed for large-scale grids and clusters. It increases application performance. It provides us a single port solution for the inter-process communication, network requirements and storage area network requirements for our supercomputer. And it's highly reliable in that the fabric management is managed with multiple subnet managers. InfiniBand differs from traditional Ethernet by having automatic configuration of all switches and ports in an InfiniBand fabric, which is performed by a component called a subnet manager. So RDMA, remote direct memory access, is a way of providing an application on two systems to communicate with each other with very low overhead. It does that by actually mapping areas of system memory between the two nodes. So with a single call, it's possible to use hardware assist to transfer data with no additional overhead required on the CPU. And now, in an HPC environment where every cycle is quite valuable, reducing the amount of communications overhead provides a significant performance increase to HPC-style jobs. So let's do a comparison between Ethernet and InfiniBand. So Ethernet is a network that we've used for around 30 years now, maybe a bit longer. It's a best effort delivery. It's allowed to drop packets and relies on the overlaying protocols like TCP/IP for reliability, which are typically re-implemented in the switch for retransmission. Ethernet supports a low-level cyclic redundancy check, which, when combined with an upper layer protocol, provides error correction and error detection. TCP is a major performance bottleneck for bandwidths of 10 gig and above, and requires some quite significant and considerable tuning to actually make TCP perform above 10 gigabytes per second. So there are explicit packet drops of flow control. So typically you will start ramping up the amount of data flow until the network can't sustain it anymore, at which time it starts dropping packets, and the overlaying protocol will make adjustments to the packet flow to fit it within the network. It supports also a concept called VLANs or virtual LANs, which allowed you to divide an Ethernet network up into multiple isolated segments for security or for manageability. Now, when we compare this to InfiniBand, InfiniBand supports a hardware-based retransmission, so there is no need for an upper-level protocol to be keeping packets or maintaining state. InfiniBand also provides both link-level and end-to-end cyclic redundancy checks. So this is to ensure that your data is being transferred across the network error-free all the time. InfiniBand provides reliability at the hardware level, which provides better throughput, less latency, and rarely causes jitter. So jitter is important in terms of the deterministic timing of arrival of packets. And in an HPC environment where synchronization across multiple devices is required, jitter becomes quite a critical thing. There is also a credit-based flow control, just a moment, we'll turn the lights back on this room, for each link, so that any endpoint is not able to saturate the network. It supports a thing called partitions, which allow you to divide an InfiniBand network up into multiple segments. So InfiniBand uses what's called a fabric rather than, is called a fabric rather than a network. Typically InfiniBand networks are built from a core number of switches. There may be an InfiniBand router connected into that. Some examples of this are the Bay Microsystems and Obsidian Strategics devices that we've used as part of our InfiniCloud and InfiniCortex project. It can also connect I/O chassis. So as an example, we have different file systems all using Lustre, but they're isolated within their own InfiniBand fabric, which then connects up into the core of InfiniBand fabric. On the right of this is a storage subsystem, which uses a device called a TCA, which I'll discuss later. However, while this was in the reference design, over a number of HPC facilities, I've never seen the implementation of a TCA-based storage system at the moment. So InfiniBand is both a high bandwidth and low latency network. Typically, it's under 0.5 microseconds and with a deterministic latency across the devices. It comes in a range of flavors from the original single data rate, which was 10 gigabytes per second, up to today's contemporary FDR, which is 56 gigabits per second or full data rate, and then 100 gig per second extended data rate. And there are roadmaps taking it up to 400 gigabits per second, and we've received the first pre-production NDR equipment at NCI that we've started to test. So while the bandwidth increases, the latency is decreasing or effectively constant. So there have been multiple generations of InfiniBand. I won't go through all of the details in this table, but basically the ones that are in common use today are FDR, which uses multiple 13.64 gig channels. EDR, which uses multiple 25 gig channels. So in most cases, it's the channels are four channels to a particular link. But the standard also does allow for eight channels for a particular link. The encoding efficiency is significantly higher than with Ethernet networks with a 64 to 66 ratio, and the adapter latency is typically less than half a millisecond. So the InfiniBand feature set, like Ethernet, InfiniBand is a layered protocol with a physical, link, network, transport and upper layers. It uses a packet-based communication. It does provide a quality of service. It's got three link speeds, as I mentioned. 1X, which is typically 2.5 gigs per link, is a 4-wire. 4X is a 16-wire interconnect, and 12X is a 48-wire interconnect. The most commonly used interconnect is a 4X. The InfiniBand is able to be run at a PCB level, so directly attached onto a device, and it also supports both copper and fibre cable interconnect. It uses what's a subnet management protocol to automatically configure the InfiniBand fabric, and has remote RDMA support, so one node can read the memory from another node. Like TCP, it supports both multicast and unicast. It has both a reliable and unreliable transport mechanism, and supports message queuing, and has both link level and end-to-end flow control. So let's look at some of the InfiniBand layers here. The physical layer presents what effectively is a MAC, but is called a GUID. I'll discuss that later. The network layer performs inter-subnet routing, typically using IPv6. The transport layer exchanges messages by what's called queue pairs. And then the host layer is what your application actually writes to. It uses a thing called InfiniBand verbs, which provide transactions between the different devices. Now, connecting those together is typically an InfiniBand switch. So in the data center, InfiniBand is a completely switched fabric topology. As I mentioned, our colleagues at ACRC and NSCC, in collaboration with NCI, have done InfiniBand routing, which has allowed us to connect 7 HPC facilities around the world using the high-speed InfiniBand. So the physical layer, let's start working our way up through the layers now. InfiniBand is a lossless fabric. It has a maximum bit error rate of 10 by minus 1 by minus 12. Many vendors offer 10 by minus 15 error rates. It supports direct attached cables as copper. There are also a range of splitter cables and adapters. It supports active optical cables and both multi-mode and single-mode optical transceivers. Now, where you use these different sort of interconnect technologies is really dependent on the size and scale of your cluster. At NCI, we use a combination of direct attached copper cables where possible, because they're around 1/10 the price of the optic cables. And those are typically within a rack themselves. If we're traversing between racks or between pods in our data center, we use active optical cables. Between our data centers, we would use a single mode optical transceiver to transport InfiniBand. So these are some examples of the physical interconnect cables. They're a fairly large chunky cable that plugs into the host adapter. By the way, these cables can also be used for 100 gig Ethernet, and our 100 gig Ethernet platform is built using exactly the same Mellanox cards, just running in Ethernet mode rather than InfiniBand mode. So the copper has almost zero power consumption, is the lowest cost and the lowest latency. And that's typically because they're the shortest cables that you have. InfiniBand optical cables have a bit error rate of less than 1 in 10 to the minus 15. They're lower power consumption. They're much lighter and easier to work with in terms of trying to route cables through racks. And they're a lot lighter and easier to transport around the data center. And also don't put as much physical strain on the overhead cable containment trays. Optical transceivers allow you to use existing fiber. They have what's called a QSFP, quad SFP form factor. They're low power consumption, and also have low latency. So, as I mentioned, InfiniBand has been evolving since around 2001 with FDR using QSFP Plus, which are a larger kind of 40 gig Ethernet interconnector. The newer generation uses a new interconnector, so that's the EDR 100 gig generation, which is QSFP28. So let's move up to the next layer of InfiniBand layers, which is the link layer. The link layer is responsible for packets, switching, maintaining quality of service, maintaining the credit-based flow control, and ensuring data integrity across the fabric. There are two types of packets in an InfiniBand network: management packets and data packets. The management packets are used for configuration and doing things like returning device information. The data packets can typically carry a 4K payload, and switching within a subnet, packet forwarding and switching is handled at the link layer. And all devices in a subnet have a 16-bit local ID, or LID, as we call it in InfiniBand terminology, which is assigned by the subnet manager. All packets within a subnet use the LID for addressing. The link layer switching forwards packets to the device, specified by the LID, which is contained within the local root header of the packet. The local root header is present in all packets. Quality of service is maintained by providing up to 16 virtual lanes. Virtual lanes are separate logical channels which share a common physical link. Virtual lane 0 to 15 are the standard data channels, with virtual lane 16 virtual lane 0 to 14 are the standard data channels, with virtual lane 15 being used for the management channel. As a packet traverses through the subnet, a service level is defined to ensure its quality of service level. Each link can have different virtual lanes, and the service level provides each link a dedicated priority of communication. So each switch or router within the InfiniBand fabric can have a different priority or quality of service and can be configured with a number of different virtual lanes. Where you would use this capability is to connect to data centers and to ensure that the traffic will actually be able to fit in the underlying network that is used for connection. So unlike Ethernet, InfiniBand uses what's called credit-based flow control. So before you're allowed to transmit on InfiniBand, you need to ask the other end for a credit. This ensures that unlike Ethernet or TCP networks, there is no need to buffer packets within the network. If the remote end is not ready to accept a packet, it will not be able to pass a credit across. So each receiving end of the link supplies credits to the sending devices, and this specifies the amount of data that can be sent without data loss. And the credit passing is maintained by a dedicated link packet, which updates the number of credits that the receiver can accept, or the number of buffers. And the data is not transmitted unless the receiver advertises that there is buffer space available to receive the data. Data integrity is managed by two cyclic redundancy checks per packet, a variant cyclic redundancy check and an invariant cyclic redundancy check. The 16-bit variant cyclic redundancy check includes all fields in the packet and is recalculated at each hop, which allows you to identify any potentially failing links within a fabric. And the 32-bit invariant CRC only covers the fields that don't change from hop to hop. So this is used to provide end-to-end data integrity between the receiver and the transmitter. So let's move up to the transport layer, or the network layer, sorry. So the network layer actually handles routing packets from one subnet to another. Within a subnet, which is typically within a data center, the network layer is not required. So the network layer provides what's called a global root header, which maps the 128-bit IPv6 address, the source and destination of the packets. And then the packets are forwarded between the subnets through a router-based device on a router-based system, which has a 64-bit globally unique identifier called GUID, G-U-I-D. The router actually modifies the local root header with a proper local address for each subnet. Therefore, the last router in the chain replaces the local ID in the local root header with the local ID of the destination port on the other end of the fabric. And as I mentioned, within the network layer, the InfiniBand packets do not require the network layer information or header information, which is used in this scenario. Let's look at the transport layer. Transport on InfiniBand is all managed in hardware. It's responsible for in-order packet delivery, partitioning of the fabric, channel multiplexing, and providing a range of transport services. from reliable datagrams through reliable connections to unreliable datagrams and unreliable connections. There is also a raw datagram capability. The transport layer supplies the maximum transfer unit of the path, and then the transport layer actually divides each of the data into packets of this size, which are the maximum transfer unit, which is passed across the network. The receiver reassembles the packet based on the base transport header that contains the destination queue pair and packet sequence number. I'll mention queue pairs as I move along a little later. The receiver acknowledges the packet, and the packet and the sender receives these acknowledges, as well as updating the incoming completion queue with the state of the operation. There are multiple transport services for that reliability. So you can basically select the sort of data transport you need, whether it's needs to be 100% reliable, whether it's packet or connection oriented, or whether your application is able to lose packets and recover successfully. So the transport layer uses what's called a queue pair. So there's one of these for each type of transport. So the classes of service, as I mentioned, are reliable connection, which is acknowledged and connection oriented. Reliable datagram, is acknowledged and multiplexed across the fabric. Unreliable connection most closely matches a TCP/IP connection, where the packets can be unacknowledged but connection oriented. An unreliable datagram is effectively maps onto a TCP UDP transmission, which is a connectionless system, and raw datagrams are basically used for configuration of the fabric management itself. So InfiniBand architecture defines multiple devices for system communication. An InfiniBand channel adapter, which is equivalent to Ethernet NIC, a switch, a router, and then a device or set of software called Subnet Manager. So within a subnet, there must be at least one channel adapter or interface card for each end node, and at least one subnet manager. All channel adapters and switches contain what's called a subnet management agent, which handles configuration of the fabric in collaboration with the subnet manager. So a channel adapter, or what's called a host channel adapter in most cases, is effectively the InfiniBand interface on the system. So these are typically PCIe devices, which provide the physical interface on the host and supports a software layer called Verbs, which is defined by the InfiniBand consortium. So the Verbs are an abstract representation which defines the communication interface required between the client and the functions of the host channel adapter. By using this level of abstraction, it's possible to have applications written to the InfiniBand Verbs level and swap out the underlying hardware between different vendors. So if the Verbs do not supply the API or application programming interface of the operating system, they provide a commonality of that layer which you can write to the operating system layer. As I mentioned, there's another form of host adapter called target channel adapter, which is typically used in NVMe over fabric, so direct attached NVMe storage into an InfiniBand network. An InfiniBand channel adapter supplies, it's an equivalent to an Ethernet NIC, supports what's called a globally unique identifier, is PCI bus connected, provides CPU offload, supports all of the end-to-end quality of service and congestion control, and come in a range of speeds. I've provided some examples of some of the InfiniBand adapters that we're using. The one at the top is what's called a Connect X3, which is a dual port 56 gig InfiniBand adapter. The one underneath it is a ConnectX 4, which is the 100 gig InfiniBand channel adapter. And the one at the very right hand most front is the ConnectX 5, which is a single channel 100 gig Ethernet and InfiniBand adapter. So InfiniBand switches are the fundamental components of the InfiniBand fabric. They contain one or more InfiniBand ports and forward packets from one port to another based on the local ID contained within the layer 2 local root header. Other than management packets, a switch does not consume or directly generate packets themselves. They're only there to forward. So switches can be configured to forward at a unicast between two single devices, or multicast packets, which are addressed to a range of devices simultaneously. The InfiniBand router is responsible for forwarding packets from one subnet to another, and it does that by manipulating a global root header and substituting the local ID or LID of one network through a global ID to a LID in another network. It rebuilds packets with a proper LID on the next subnet. Just to give you an idea of some of the difference in performance capability between InfiniBand and Ethernet. Let's have a look at the two right-hand, or the right-hand green and the right-hand orange column. So this was exactly the same network underlying the data transfer, using TCP/IP tools took 3 hours for the same data set. That was reduced to 7 minutes using InfiniBand tools. A 9-hour TCP transport was reduced to around 24 minutes using InfiniBand tools. So as you can perceive, there's a significant advantage performance-wise and data transfer-wise by using direct InfiniBand rather than translating into TCP/IP. So the subnet manager configures the local subnet and ensures it's operating. There has to be one subnet manager at least. Multiple subnets are supported. They manage all of the switches, routers, and host configuration. They communicate with the subnet using a dedicated subnet management agent, and multiple subnet managers can reside in the fabric as long as only one is active. Subnet managers use QPair 0, which is handled exclusively on a high priority virtual lane, VL 15, to ensure management operation of the subnet is always consistent. And one of the most popular subnet managers is an open subnet manager called OpenSN. So there are two methods of system management, subnet management and general services. Each method has a dedicated queue pair and is supported by all devices. Subnet management is handled by a subnet manager. This configuration provides LID assignments, local IDs, SL to VL mapping, so system layer to virtual layer mapping, link initialization, and link failover. Subnet management packets are usually pronounced as thumps, and the only packets allowed over QPair 0. This virtual layer uses the unreliable datagram transport service and does not follow the same flow control on other virtual lanes of the links. So this allows the fabric to configure itself automatically and be resilient to packet storms that may be occurring on the fabric. The general services interface manages functions such as out-of-band I/O operations, fuzzy management. These functions do not need the same high priority as subnet manager does. They're normally pronounced as gumps, and they don't use the high-level virtual priority lane. So I mentioned earlier about a thing called queue pairs. A queue pair is the presentation at the operating system or application level, which define the number of send and receive packets which are queued for transmission. Now, as I mentioned, all of the InfiniBand interaction is actually hardware accelerated. So the presentation at the application level is what's called a write queue pair, what's with the WQE, or a CQE, which is a receive queue pair. So when packets are moved between InfiniBand adapters, the data is moved directly into host memory, and then the host is informed about which queue pair has actually completed. InfiniBand is completely hardware offloaded. So it's a high-speed, low latency. It offloads all of the normal TCP protocol overhead. For communication between devices, a work queue pair is assigned on each end. The client places a transaction into a work queue, typically called a work queue entry or WQE. When the remote device responds, the channel data returns the status to the client saying it's complete. The client can place multiple work queue entries, and the channel adapter hardware will handle the transmission and notification. The CQE, which is a completion queue entry, provides a status for each of the work queue entries in prioritized order. So what this allows the system to do is actually proceed with other activities while transmission is occurring between different nodes. So network segmentation in InfiniBand uses partitions, which uses a thing called a P key. There's a very similar to Ethernet VLANs and can be used to divide your network up into different customers, applications, security zones, or quality of service levels. The global identifier is a 128-bit, not 133-long, I'll have to use my slide, filled in the global routing header used to route packets between different InfiniBand subnets. It's only used in the very limited rooted InfiniBand environment. So a local identifier is a 16-bit layer 2 address signed by the subnet manager when ports become active. These are not persistent between reboots. There are also a number of reserved lids, which allow you to address either unicast or multicast, and some of them are reserved for special use. So all InfiniBand nodes have both a globally unique ID, or GUID, and a lid. The GUID is 64 bits. It's kind of similar to an Ethernet MAC address, but slightly longer. Ethernet MACs are 48. They're assigned by the InfiniBand vendor and are persistent between reboots. This allows you to actually identify which particular card within a system that you're talking to. And the InfiniBand switch is able to present multiple address GUIDs, which allow the node to identify a host channel adapter. So let's now look through the subnet management and fabric configuration process. First of all, there's a physical subnet establishment phase, followed by a discovery phase, information gathering then occurs. The local IDs are assigned to each of the devices within a fabric. The path is established. The ports are then configured on the end nodes. The switches are configured, and then the subnet is activated, which allows.
You want direct one, right? You want direct one, right?
So fabric information gathered during discovery includes the node information, types, number of ports, the GUID, and partition tables, quotes. The port information includes the forwarding database size, the maximum transmission unit, the width, and the number of virtual lanes. After a subnet manager finishes gathering any information needed about the subnet, it assigns a base lid and LMC to each one of the attached endpoints. The lid is assigned to a port rather than a device level. And a D-lead is used as the main address for an InfiniBand packet to be switched. Each switch port can be identified by a combination of the lid and the port number. So you'll see in this example that to talk between lid 81 and lid 72 requires the packet to traverse up to lid 21, across lid 3, down lid 22, down lid 75, down to lid 81. So the basic fabric concept, the basic management concepts of an InfiniBand fabric are that a node is any managed entity, be it an end node, a switch, or a router. The subnet manager is the active entity which sources commands and queries. An agent is a passive entity which exists on every InfiniBand device, which allows to respond to subnet manager queries. And the MAD, or management access datagram, is the communications form carried between different subnet, carried across the subnet for management itself. Let's move on to InfiniBand technologies. So InfiniBand can be supports a number of different topologies. The topology selection really depends on the sort of application workload that you wish to run. So what topologies are protective geometry-based flat meshes. These can be described as directed acyclic graphs. There is a whole area of information theory on graph theory. So I won't go into much detail on this. You can build graphs of varying sizes, which have a range of either fully committed bandwidth, which is called bisectional bandwidth. Some of our topology choices are all-to-all, which is pretty much is only used in quite small clusters. All-to-all provides the highest bisectional bandwidth, but as I said, they're restricted to small clusters. Most commonly used is a fully fat tree, which uses what's called a closet topology, which is kind of tree structure topology, which are well suited for MPI jobs and smaller node counts in the range of under 64,000. Fat tree is quite expensive though, and that the cabling and switching topologies become increasingly dense as the cluster grows. With examples, as I showed you in one of our earlier slides, where you have 622 port devices in the core of the fat tree. Standard hypercubes are an evolving technology, which are ideal for large node count, MPI or message passing interface jobs. They scale extremely well from small to large clusters and allow multiple orthogonal dimensions of interconnect. Typically, the standard hypercube provides the lightest weight fabric at the lowest cost with a single cable used for each link. The choice of the topology is based on the cost of the cables and the switches, the bisectional bandwidth requirements, and the computational mechanism that is required for a particular job. At NCI, we have a fully fat tree topology, which gives us the best mix of full bisectional bandwidth, but at the expense of significantly greater interconnect cable costing. Basically, let's consider each vertex switch. Each switch has a link of 3 times ports. This allows 8x3, 24 ports to be used for the switch link. Each switch is involved in having 12 local servers and relaying data from 6 other servers. This basically looks like the 12 outgoing servers carrying 12 outgoing links carrying data from 18 servers, which provides a 1.5:1 oversubscription ratio of the network, or within the fabric, I should say. Let's skip that one. So some of the more commonly used InfiniBand fabric topologies are a simple back-to-back fabric, a two-tier or three-tier fat tree, which is the model that NCI uses, a 3D torus, a dual star, or a hybrid, a mixture of or a combination of these topologies. topologies. So the building blocks are 36-port InfiniBand switches. These have less than 90-second port-to-port latency. The switches themselves are fully crossbar switching, so there's non-blocking. And an example that I provided here, and I'd like to thank Mellanox for a number of the graphics and also tables that I've used in my presentation. And the example of this is an SB7700, which is a 36-port 100-gig InfiniBand switch. So InfiniBand switches are currently coming in both FDR, full data rate, 56 gig, and EDR, extended data rate, 100 gig. They have 18 ports facing out per leap, with 18 ports facing in internally, which provides full bisectional bandwidth across the switch itself. So in this example, we look at 1,944-port 0 subscription, in which we do 6 links up into the core from each of the leaf switches, which provides us the capability for each leaf switch to connect up to 30 nodes. There are a number of link distribution and routing equations that can be used. They basically determine either an up-down or a cluster-based architecture. And using the FAT tree, the minimum self-contained cluster will be 54 nodes. Using the quasi-FAT tree or an up-down will allow you to have 324 nodes as the minimum minimum configuration. So when you exceed the local 65,000 node limit, it's possible to build multiple two-level FAT tree islands. These are using 36 ports to interconnect the InfiniBand switches themselves with up to 576 servers connected per InfiniBand switch. A 3D torus works by folding the InfiniBand around itself to create a cross-connect mesh. Now, I haven't experienced the use of a 3D torus, but I believe the folks at Oak Ridge National Lab run their machine as a 4x4 or a multiple 4x4 torus. So creating the torus with InfiniBand switches allows for linear expandability without recabling. It's shorter cables for simpler wiring. It works best for localized communication, has lower cost power and cooling with fewer switches and cables, and is able to connect storage into the junction of each cube. It does provide fault tolerance, and has built-in support for adaptive routing, congestion control, and quality of service. This is an example in the SDSC, which is the San Diego Supercomputer Center Gordon cluster. As you can see, they've got they run a number of hypercubes, which are connected together into a 3D torus. So hypercubes, the equations for those is the diameter is expressed in K. The maximum number of switches is 2 by the power of the diameter. Scaling is not as easy or nice as a 3D torus. And unlike the 3D torus, the edge vertex can extend to each switch. The server to external link ratio depends on the size of the torus and the congested bisectional bandwidth, so the amount of oversubscription that you engineer into your fabric. Dragonfly is one of the more emerging topologies. It's a concept of connecting virtual routers or groups in a pool graph. basically this is used for having typically a compute cluster connected via Dragonfly, connected to a fully factory storage cluster, where the computational jobs are talking much more between themselves in the compute side, and have a much more localized data access pattern. So credit loops is something that needs to be concerned about with designing a Dragonfly system. To ensure that you don't introduce loops into the underlying fabric topology. The subnet manager will detect and resolve most of these, but the implication is that the performance is not up to the level that your original design would have expressed. So, in a 2048 node Dragonfly, each group consists of 128 servers across two racks. There are 8x8 EDR switches in each group with a total of 64 short cables, connection to racks for hosts within a rack, and 64 slightly longer cables for connection across the racks. So, just as a comparison between a CLOS or fully fat tree, an example node count, a fully fat tree will support 1,944 compared to 2048. It will require 270 switches compared to 256. We'll need 1,944 short cables, 1,944 long cables compared to 4,096 short, and 1,920 long. And if you remember, as I said earlier, the short cables are about 1/10 the cost of the long cables. So the main differences between Dragonfly and fully fat tree are the blocking ratio of 1-to-1 contention fat tree versus a 1-to-2 oversubscription ratio within Dragonfly. Fat tree can have a worst case switch hop of 5 compared to 4 in Dragonfly. And the host grouping configuration is more ideal with more hosts in a fat tree versus smaller number of hosts in Dragonfly. So in summary, we've looked at what InfiniBand is. It's a fabric, lossless, hardware error correction and offloading network with high bandwidth and extremely low latency. InfiniBand has evolved from 10 gig to 200 gig currently available. We've looked at the InfiniBand feature set. We've looked at InfiniBand layers, the physical layer, the link layer, the network layer, the transport layer, and IDMA. We've looked at InfiniBand elements, the channel adapters, switches, routers, the subnet manager. We've touched briefly on the aspects of subnet management, discovery, configuration, and ongoing fabric management. We've looked at how InfiniBand provides complete hardware offload for data communications, which avoids needing to use CPU and host resources, which would be needed if you're using a traditional protocol like TCP/IP. We've looked at queue pairs and the way the RDMA works, where the memory of one system is mapped into the memory of another. We've looked at network segmentation using pkeys and network partitions. We've briefly touched on network addressing, the GUIDs, LIDs, and GIDs. We've looked at the fabric configuration process, what is learned through discovery, the LOD assignments, and we've also covered briefly some of the InfiniBand fabric topologies, topology choices, examples, of being Fat Tree, 3D Torus, Hybrid, and Dragonfly. So with that, I hope I haven't overwhelmed you too much by trying to compress a day into an hour, but I hope I've also given you a kind of an introduction or a taste of InfiniBand. If you're interested in any more in further details, I'd strongly recommend that it's worthwhile taking the InfiniBand course from Mellanox. But Also, I'd like to shout out to a number of the people on this video call who have dealt with InfiniBand Fabrics. Both NSCC and NCI use InfiniBand extensively within our data centres. Singapore and Australia, through SingAREN and RNET, have done some of the foundation InfiniBand routing development, and we've extended this across 7 HPC facilities on 4 continents. With that, I'd like to acknowledge Mellanox, who are the company that has provided our InfiniBand fabrics, both at NSCC and NCI, for providing many of the graphics and letting me selectively chop down their introduction to InfiniBand day to just a very short course. And I'd also like to acknowledge our funding streams, National Research Infrastructure Australia, the Australian Research Council, the Australian National University, the Australian Government, the Bureau of Meteorology, CSIRO, and Geoscience Australia. And with that, thank you very much, and I'd like to open it up to questions.
Hey, thank you very much, Andrew, for sharing with us about InfiniBand. So we are now open for questions. Is there anything that you all want to ask Andrew? Please feel free to voice your question.
Hello, Andrew. Alvin here.
Hi.
Hi. I want to ask about the subnet manager. Is it a device or is it a role assigned to a Mellanox switch? How does this subnet manager?
It's a couple of different variations. Mellanox supports the subnet manager actually running embedded within the switch. But more traditionally, you'd have one or more endpoint devices. In our case, we just use exactly the same hardware as we use for the HPC. But divide a couple of nodes off, which runs the Open Subnet Manager application itself. Mellanox also provide what's called UFM, which is their Unifying Fabric Manager, which is both a combination of an endpoint node and specialized subnet manager software. There are a couple of other variations in subnet management which we've used in InfiniCortex. That being BGFC, the Bowman Fabric Gateway Control, which was a proprietary subnet manager developed by City of Strategics.
Because I see the subnet manager to have a very important role to assign the LID and GUID. So
yeah.
If it goes down, should there be some redundancy or something?
Yeah, we recommend at least 2, possibly 3 or 4. So there needs to be at least 1 subnet manager in the fabric, and a subnet manager existing. When you have an extended InfiniBand network, a subnet manager actually existing across in each of the different InfiniBand networks. One of the issues we ran into in the early iterations in InfiniCortex, we had a single subnet manager. So if we hit link congestion, the whole network or the whole InfiniBand fabric globally would start falling apart. So InfiniCortex 2.0 changed that architecture to localize subnet manager within each fabric. Okay. So it's a fairly lightweight operation, which if you really needed to, you could share running on another node as well. So we just have general service nodes which run that. They also run our monitoring and packet capture capability.
Okay, thank you.
So from the others participants, do you have any questions for Andrew?
Hello, Andrew.
Hi, Ken.
Hi, yeah.
Hi, Kenneth. Yeah, what's your question? Yeah.
Okay. I just want to ask if there's any other learning environment that we could somehow emulate or practice the technology, because as I see, it's mainly hardware. So,
I believe Mellanox have a lab environment, but you need to subscribe. I think there's a subscription cost of around $1,500 per year to use that. Perhaps if I could throw this question over to Dr. Ann at ACRC, they may be able to set up a development environment for you to actually do some work on a, you know, using one switch to build yourself out of a small cluster.
There is no way that the function could be emulated on a software level. It's all purely hardware.
It could be, but I've just never seen an implementation of that. Mellanox, I believe, that when you spin up their lab environment, that actually configures a hardware-based network for you, which is why they've got that cost in there. Typically, InfiniBand is kind of more of a data center level technology, and people are prepared to pay to actually learn the fundamentals. Whereas in a cloud environment, you know, it's easy to spin a TCP network environment. It's really easy to spin this stuff up as a cloud instance, and a lot cheaper to build a lab environment there. But I'll keep my ears open for any virtualized environments that I can find, and get in late to forward that detail to you if I locate it.
Okay, that would be great. Thank you.
Not a problem.
Okay, so any more questions for Andrew? Please feel free to share your questions.
And if I've gone too fast on any of this, please let me know, and I can kind of zoom a bit deeper into any of those layers if you want to. I know this is it's quite an overwhelming number of slides that I've just thrown at you, so not surprising that you're trying to absorb a lot of information.
I guess the others I think they do not have questions for now, but I guess if they have any more questions, they could contact you in future. Is that possible?
Not a problem at all. So yeah. BingLane has all my details. I think it's published on the site as well.
Sure.
I'd suggest probably your kind of first port of call would be to also involve Gok Lian, who is also quite an expert on this, but I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have that you think of going forward.
Sure. So, Andrew, would you be able to share the slides with us for this presentation?
Just let me fix a couple of the spelling errors and numbers that I got wrong, sure. And I'll get back to you probably tomorrow or next day.
Oh, no issues. Okay. And then, I have received a question from Siyuan to ask whether there's a recording of this seminar. So the answer is yes. We'll actually post this on our YouTube page. And then we'll share the link with our community as well as the slides from Andrew. So in case y'all want to review the presentation again, you can feel free to do so. So no issues. Yeah. So
need to decode my accent a bit more.
Sorry, again?
You need to decode my Australian accent a bit more.
No, it's okay. So I guess there's no more further questions. I'd like to thank Andrew really for your time and sharing with us all your knowledge. And thank you very much. And we also thanks for everybody who took the time to participate in this seminar. So just want to should we put our hands together to thank everyone. Thanks. Okay, thank you.
Thanks for everyone's time.
Thanks,
Andrew.
Okay, bye-bye. Yeah, bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks for being live for organizing this. It's pretty much appreciated.
Yeah.